Hi, my name is Jane. I'm from a primary school in a rural setting in Samarahan area, Borneo. I've been a teacher for 15 years. I primarily teach science and also English. I enjoy teaching. It's something I enjoy doing. I enjoy seeing kids learning, growing. What challenges do I face in this current school? So I'll have to share a little bit story about my school. I come from a Malay community school. They are mainly laborers, farmers. They have an income of averagely, I would say less than 500 ringgit. They will need support from our government to be able to send their kids to school. And with that, the challenges we face in this community, in this school, is engagement. Engagement in sense of parents, in sense of kids wanting to learn, and probably infrastructure as well, because we face internet issues, devices issue, whereby I've got parents coming in to me saying, I've got five kids, but I only have one smartphone. If we were to learn using an online platform or through social media communications, it's gonna be an issue. So they will ask so that we can give them online materials through just WhatsApp, and then they'll come back to us when they can find internet connectivity through WhatsApp as well. This has caused a lot of problem for parents as well as teachers to get learning going, especially during this pandemic era. And also, I think it's also about getting parents to be involved, to be able to cooperate with the teachers so that kids can learn at home by teachers sharing materials, guidance that is relevant to them. So that's one of the challenges that we see when we're doing online learning. I think it's also about discipline at home. I feel that parents find it really difficult to handle their kids at home, especially when all of them are at home at the same time. So when we talk about physical classrooms, we can talk to 1 versus 25, and we can gauge if they're paying attention, having engagement. But when we're doing things online, I'm not sure whether I'm talking to the kids or I'm talking to the parents, because who's holding the phone? So I have to be careful of the language I use, the tone I have, to then ensure that I'm actually talking politely, differently. Because when you talk to adults to teach, it's a different tone, different way of speaking. Especially when you talk kids, you have to bring in a different, in a way, different language so that they can understand you. That's one of the things that I, as a teacher, when I do online learning, when I do online teaching, it's a perspective that I consider when I'm telling them, instructing them to do things. Another thing, when kids come back to me at work and I give them correction, when they say that they've done the work and they feel that they've done it, that's it, you know? And I say, no, you've got a lot of mistakes, you have to do corrections. And they don't come back to me with it because they feel that I've done my work, it's enough. And that's the issue that we face. So I'm waiting to be able to see them to actually help them to learn. I mean, it's great that they actually, that's the first step. They can come back to me with their work and I can see what they're learning and I know what they don't understand. But yeah, the next step is to be able to get them to, you know, correct their mistakes, to learn. You know, if you're just using whatever that's in your head and you assume that I've learned something, it's not going to progress you. Physical classroom, that would be the best, but I know if that is not a solution, I feel that probably a different way of giving them materials. For example, okay, let's talk about giving them Google Forms to fill in, whereby they have to give answers there and then. So give them an exercise, there and then they have to answer. So that is why we have got all these issues. If I give in that way, and then they don't have a device, then they can't interact with me. So I'm only thinking about, currently I'm mind-boggled about how to solve this issue, but I'm really hoping that I can see them face-to-face. That's the only thing I think of. Last year I wasn't teaching this class, so this year I actually was given to teach this class, and the parents are so different. They are so willing to be supporting the teachers to help the kids learn, and it's a jarring difference between parents that are supportive and parents that are not. And I feel that's the way to kind of tackle this issue now. Everybody's supporting each other. I mean, if us teachers put in an effort, parents put in an effort, I'm sure the kids will have some sort of benefit, have an impact towards them. But yeah, I think it's just, for your question, the answer would be the difference between, you know, different households, those that are, you know, economically, socially capable to support their kids. I feel kids, they can learn. They are resilient to whatever you throw to them. I feel that as long as you give them something to engage their interest, to be able to, in a way, find passion about learning something, I feel that they do learn. It's just a matter of how much do they learn. I would like to say that, you know, as an educator, right, when we face this sort of different times, we have to change the way we approach teaching. In a way that when the parents are saying, okay, you can't give me Google Forms because I can't get my kids to have devices that they can answer direct. So they're asking for, just revert me back to textbooks. And I go like, okay, if that's the resources that you have, then I will have to make it in such a way that the textbook is interesting. It's able for you to understand through it, but I need to give them instructions that resonates with them. Because if they're just asked to read a certain page out of the textbook, they're not going to really understand it. But if you come up with other things, a module, for example, okay, you insert certain instructions here, pay attention to this, highlight something within the text, draw an extra picture so that they can understand the text. If you come out with those kind of materials, yes, the resources are at home, but if you support it with other things that helps the students understand, I think that's the only way we can help them now at this point in time. We try to come out with modules, we say modules, but I think it's a very vague term to say a module because it's just the textbook, a page from the textbook, but we insert things that they can extract from it. Because that's the resources they have. If they have to rely on things that we have to complete, something completely new, then to be able to come out of those materials and pass it to them, it's another issue. I like to share a story about when I had them for a good 3 months last year because we managed to get them back to our physical classroom. And a story about how I used games. And okay, so they had to be seated physically distancing among their friends. And to play games this way, you gotta adapt the rules of the game. You have to play it a different way. So instead of them challenging each other, I got them to challenge me. And when they have that opportunity to play a game and challenge the teacher, you can see that they are so eagerly wanting to collaborate with their friends to figure out how we're gonna beat this teacher now. And I can see that they really, really want to play with me. And they want to play against each other as well, but of course we can't. But when we have this sort of games where they can challenge the teacher and get them to collaborate, although they can't physically, you know, be close to each other, but you can see that they're communicating. And that's where my lesson objective was, because I need them to speak. And with them to speak the English language. And I see with that game, I see that, okay, I've achieved my learning objective, and I myself enjoy the lesson because the kids are enjoying it. And when they enjoy it, I enjoy it. At the end of the lesson, I was like, okay, so you've learned to use this sort of sentence structure or question structure to query me, to challenge me, and you've learned something. One of the issues that we face as well as teachers is to find a balance between completing our syllabus, really getting our kids or our students to understand. So we are cogs to finish our syllabus last year. And to enable us to do that, some teachers have resorted to just giving worksheets, tried to get students to understand but failed, and then lastly just gave them answers to copy and put it into the worksheet and said, okay, kids have understood. And it has come down to that because we need to find a balance between getting our syllabus completed and, you know, really making sure kids understand. Sadly, I don't know whether kids are going to be able to really understand if we go back and teach them again, because I have a feeling it's just gonna be, I still don't understand. I just copied the answer. And I go like, Gloria, but we can't blame the teachers because they need to complete the syllabus. And it's with this worksheets or evidence that showed that, okay, I've taught this, I think they've understood by getting this worksheet done, and that's it. First, emotionally, I feel sad for the kids. I'm also very scared for them because I fear that they don't enjoy learning anymore. I fear that they feel that, hey, I've gone by a year without learning. It's fine. I enjoy it. Rather be just not learning. And that's one thing that I have to consider when we actually do see them, to get them to be able to have that joy in learning again, to enjoy the classroom again. And with that thought, with that motivation, I would say I would have to structure my teaching style so that that they will actually enjoy learning, and they will actually enjoy understanding things again, getting their brains to turn again. And before this, they're already having difficulties churning out ideas from their heads, and to get them to go back after a year's rest, after a year of not practicing, it's gonna be difficult. But I'm being optimistic. I feel that kids, as long as you give them the right environment, I think they can jump back, they can pop back and hopefully have some sort of learning. But saying that, I'm not going to put a lot of high objectives for me to achieve. I'm not going to make sure that, okay, today you have to do this. If you can only do 1, 2, 3, I'm happy with it. As long as you're enjoying to come into my classroom and learn, for me, it's more important, because content, you can learn it. If you can't get it done this year, the content will always be there. But if you enjoy learning and you find learning is fun, learning is something I enjoy doing in my pastime or not forced to do, I feel that I've achieved something. That's my goal.